Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's joint seminar. We are very happy to have Giuseppe Policastro from Ernest Paris to tell us about his work on transport in TTbar-deformed conformal field theories. So please take it away, Giuseppe.
Thanks, Dongsheng, and the organizers of this series for inviting me. Today I will tell you about this work that we did with two collaborators from ENS, Marco Medenjak and Takato Yoshimura, who were both postdoc at ENS, although Takato now has left for Tokyo. He's got a position in Japan. And so, yeah, we analyzed the properties of transport in TTbar-deformed conformal field theories. This is the outline of the talk. First, I will introduce the concept of the TTbar-deformation and some of the properties that they have. Then I will recall some basics of transport theory. Then I will discuss the holographic dual of the TTbar deformation and the way we used it to analyze this problem. And then finally, I will see how, I will tell you how the holographic results can also be obtained with the approach from generalized hydrodynamics. So the motivation for our work, we had several motivations. The main one is probably that we saw that the TTbar deformation can give us a very nice and solvable example of a system of verticality. And so in a way, this can be seen as a generalization of the nonlinear Luttinger liquid. The Luttinger liquid is a universal kind of model for transport in a, well, not quite universal, but very commonly used model for transport at the critical point in one plus one dimension. And it basically amounts to a free boson or free fermion theory. So it's a non, describes a non-interacting system at the critical point. And then when you want to study what happens when you move slightly away from the critical point, you can introduce perturbations and consider a nonlinear Luttinger liquid. And a TTbar is a generalization of that because we don't, we are not limited to just free theory. We can consider any interacting two-dimensional CFT that describes the critical system of interest. From the point of view of a holographist, let's say this provides a non-trivial test of the deformed, in the sense of TTbar, deformed holographic correspondence that had been tested mostly at the level of thermodynamics and similar properties. And a larger goal in the future would be to establish a more deep connection, a more precise connection between holography and generalized hydrodynamics and integrability. And here what I want to stress is the fact that the integrability appears here in a different way as the way we are mostly used to, which is via the connection from the integrable spin chain, say in ADS5 times S5, as is well known, there is an auxiliary integrable system which is made from the spin chain that describes the single trace operators. And then the integrability allows you to find exactly the spectrum of operators. But this applies mostly to low or not too high energy operators. So this integrability, it's not fully established at the level of very high operators with dimension that scales like n squared. And so in particular, when you go to finite temperature, where the free energy of the system goes like n squared, this usual integrability correspondences breaks down, or at least it's not, we don't know yet how to make it very useful. In this case, it's a different setting. It's in 1+1 dimension. It's not an auxiliary system which is integrable, but it's just the field theory itself. And so the connection could be more direct and should hold also at finite temperature. So this is the idea. And now, TTbar deformations introduced by Zamorodchuk. I don't know if you can see, because I have a thing covering part of my screen, but maybe you don't see it.
We can see your slides and the pointer. There's no other thing that shades your slides.
Okay. So, all right. And then after the paper of Smirnov with Zamolodchikov in 2016, the subject has caught up, and there has been a lot of activity in this area. So the main or the defining property of TTbar deformation is that you introduce it as an irrelevant perturbation of the Lagrangian. So you start from a Lagrangian and you perturb it infinitesimally away with the deformation parameter delta sigma by adding to the Lagrangian the determinant of the stress energy tensor, which itself depends on sigma. So you have to iterate this construction and build the deformation as a flow along this parameter. You cannot just add directly the original T with the finite parameter. That would not be the same thing. And in complex coordinates, this determinant is TT bar minus theta squared, where theta is the trace of T. So it is non-zero generically because you break conformal invariance when you deform. But when you are sitting at the conformal point, theta is zero. And so that's why it's called the TT bar deformation. And it's an operator of dimension four. So it's an irrelevant perturbation. And since this is a composite operator, one has to define it with some care. And one way to do it is to point split the so define this composite operator by point splitting the two insertions. And then the crucial observation of Zamolodchikov was that when you then take the limit of this regulator to zero, so when two points approach each other, the limit is non-singular up to a total derivative terms. So there is the singular terms in the OP. When you take this particular combination of the determinant, they combine to give a total derivative. And so if you can ignore these total derivatives, then the operator is well defined. So in particular, you can add it to the partition function and it will be fine. But you need to have more care when this total derivative might contribute. So for example, if you're computing correlation functions, then you have other insertion points, and then you have to see what happens with these singular terms when they collide with the other insertion points. And so the definition of correlator is a bit more tricky. This still people are working on it. But one consequence is that the when you consider the wave of the stress energy tensor in an eigenstate, then one can see that it factorizes into point functions. Basically, it does not depend on the different of the positions. So you can factorize and reduce it to a product of 1-point functions. And then you get an evolution equation for the eigenvalue, so for the energy spectrum, which can be solved. And when you are in a finite volume, you get an exact formula for the spectrum, which can be resummed. And you get the exact solution for the theory. And here you see that two cases arise according to what is the sign of the deformation parameter. If the sign of sigma is positive, then the square root is positive, but you have a Hagedorn growth of states for high energy. And so the theory resembles a string theory. In fact, it has some kind of non-locality, so that the UV theory, it's no longer a local CFT, it becomes a non-local theory, but still well-defined. Whereas if the parameter is negative, then in the square root you have a negative argument, and so you get complex spectrum, and the theory ceases to be well-defined. Now, another way of seeing this deformation, which is important for our application, is that it can be seen as a perturbation of the S matrix. So if you start with a theory that has a certain S matrix, it can be shown that the TT bar is just obtained by applying to this, attaching to the S matrix a phase, so-called the CDD factor, which preserves the property that an S matrix should have. And also, if the theory is integrable, this does not break the integrability. And so this phase depends on the energy and momenta of the incoming particles in this particular combination. Now, normally, we define an S matrix only for massive theories, in which case this will be, it will have this form with the cinch of the difference of the rapidities. But actually, it is important for us that one can formally also consider the massless limit, where the scattering matrix, strictly speaking, does not make sense anymore. But as we will see, you can still apply the formalism of TBA equations and and recover some information here. This m squared, when the mass tends to zero, is substituted by some normalization scale, which, however, cancels in all the physical quantities. So it's just some arbitrary scale. You can see that you can remove it by redefining, by shifting the rapidities. And conceptually, it's also important that one can also see the TT bar as coupling the theory to JT gravity. And this is quite simple to see at the classical level, because if you start with your action and add the JT gravity action, so just the gravity plus a dilaton into D with this action. This is a flat space JT, because the equation of motion of the dilaton tells you that R equals zero. Then you can integrate out both the metric and the dilaton. The equation of motion of the metric gives an equation for the dilaton, which can be solved, and in terms of the stress energy tensor of the matter theory, and this is the solution that you find. So this gives a deformation of the metric, which is this combination of T, and when you plug it in the action, you get the JT part of the action exactly becomes this TT bar determinant of T deformation, with the cosmological constant playing the role of the deformation parameter. Now, because the metric is flat, this allows for yet another interpretation, because in two dimensions, a flatness of the metric means that it actually can be found as a coordinate transformation. So in two dimensions, any metric is conformally flat, and if in addition is just flat, then it's just a reparametrization. And one can explicitly find this vector field, which corresponds to the reparametrization. It's not the most general one, it's a curl-free vector field, as you can see from this epsilon. So it's some kind of integral of the stress energy tensor. Because it's curl free, you can integrate along any contour. The interpretation is easier if the contour is chosen to be on the real axis, as you would normally do if you do canonical quantization of the theory. And then the time component of the reparametrization is the integral of the momentum density. And so it turns out that you integrate in the with different sign from the left and the right, and for the space component you get the time component of the, so the energy density. In the theory and the deformed theory, and you are following a certain trajectory in space-time. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, I thought I lost you.
There was a bit of cut just now.
Basically, an observer moving in the space-time will experience a contraction or time dilation of space contraction, which is determined by this equation. So we will perceive the space and time differently depending on the overall matter, so energy and momentum distribution around it. And this time delay can be shown to be related to the phase shift that that appears in the S matrix. So it's an equivalent description. So this property of TTbar has been particularly emphasized by Cardi, and it has given rise to a kind of slogan that TTbar deformed CFT is just a CFT in a deformed geometry. But this slogan is not completely precise for two things. First of all, because it only makes sense classically or at most in perturbation theory. Because you see that here we are interpreting a coordinate change with some expression involving the stress energy tensor. So classically it's fine, but if you are in the quantum theory, this is an operator. And what does it mean that you interpret a coordinate change as an operator? So it's a state dependent, if you want, coordinate change, a dynamical or state dependent geometry. And so even though you can say it's a CFT in the deformed geometry, the fact that this geometry is dynamical or state dependent makes some important differences, as we will see. Finally, holographically, in this nice paper of Verlinde and collaborators, was interpreted as the deformation was interpreted as putting a finite radius cutoff in ADS. And later, Monica Guica with Ruben Monten, they showed that one can also interpret this as imposing mixed boundary conditions for the fluctuations of the metric at infinity. And they argued that this is actually a better description for a few different reasons. So first of all, how does it work? You recall that any asymptotically ADS3 metric in Pfeffermann-Gram coordinates can be written in this way, with a radial expansion which stops at second order and in three dimensions with pure gravity. This is an exact expansion, you don't need higher order terms. And the standard correspondence tells you that the G0, here the leading term in the Pfeffermann-Gram expansion, has to be identified with the boundary metric, and the second term with the BEV of the stress energy tensor. If you deform the theory, since TTbar is a double trace deformation, so Guica and Monten analyzed and they derived this correspondence, the deformation tells you that you have to identify the boundary metric, which I define here as gamma mu. So it's the boundary metric at the value of the mu of the deformation parameter, as this particular combination of the coefficients of the Pfeffermann-Gram expansion. and the stress energy tensor is this other combination. So when you combine the two, you can see that this is a mixed nonlinear boundary condition because you're constraining together all the terms in the expansion. But it just so happens that this combination for the boundary metric is exactly the induced metric when you take the radial coordinates to be equal to the deformation parameter. And so it just so happens that this can also be interpreted as putting a Dirichlet boundary condition at the finite radial cutoff given by mu. However, this interpretation only this only works in the case when you have pure gravity. When you couple gravity to other matter fields, the expansion will change and this will not work anymore. So, whereas this is always true, this mixed boundary condition interpretation always makes sense. The finite cutoff only works for pure gravity. And then one other thing to say is that here I have introduced this parameter mu, which parameterizes the deformation. And before, in field theory, I had a different parameter sigma. You can show that the two are related in this way, with the factor of the central charge. And there is a minus sign. And now from this, you can make two observations. First, that if you want sigma to be positive, to have both signs, then mu also should have both signs. But the finite radius deformation, the cutoff interpretation only makes sense for one sign when mu is positive, whereas the mixed boundary condition can be applied for both signs. So also in this sense, it is more general. Also, because it's the C sigma combination that appears in gravity, if you want to see this deformation in the geometry, this cutoff has to be remain fixed in units of the ADS radius, and that means that when you send sigma to infinity, you have to send the deformation to zero in a way that sigma C stays fixed. So holographically, we only have access to this kind of double scaling limit of the deformation. Now, an important property of this flow, if you consider this family of perturbations as a flow, is that this flow preserves the flatness of the boundary metric. So the mu derivative of square root of boundary metrics times r is zero. And so if the metric is flat, then it will be flat at all point in the flow, which simplifies the analysis considerably. The general case where the boundary metric is not flat, as far as I know, has not been completely analyzed, but it would be needed in order to define all the correlation functions of the theory. But yeah, we will limit to the case when we just have flat boundary metric. And as I said in the beginning, with this prescription, one can check that the thermodynamics of a black hole with this boundary condition is in agreement with the formula for the free energy that you get from the field theory analysis. Now, there has been a lot of activity, as I said, involving this these theories with some effort into solving this flow equation for the classical theory, some activity in computing the correlation functions. You can also try to find higher dimensional analogs, also lower dimensional analogs, a sort of TTbar deformation of quantum mechanics when was considered by Gross and collaborators. I will come to the end to some other generalization where you can deform the theory with different conserved charges. Okay, let me skip this. And and some work by Bernard and Doyon and by Cardi and Doyon on the non-equilibrium physics of these theories, which will be our concern for this talk. So now I will move to the next part if there are no questions. And tell you about the transport properties that we are interested in. So I will remind you that in hydrodynamics, you assume that the large scale dynamics of the theory is described by the fluctuations of the conserved charges that obey the conservation equation. In this case, we are interested in energy and momentum, so we have two conserved charges. And the basic transports are encoded in two matrices, which are the Drude weights and the Onsager matrix, which can be defined like, there are many definitions. One possible definition is this one, which has an intuitive interpretation because it tells you that if you consider the correlator of the fluctuations of conserved charges, then you have, suppose you have the charge is fluctuating and then it moves ballistically, so with the constant velocity, like a free particle, then in this integral, the x squared term will be dominated by the linear propagation, and then in the integral will behave like t squared, and the coefficient is the Drude weight. So the Drude weight encodes the ballistic propagation of excitations in the theory. Whereas if you have diffusive excitations, then as is well known, a diffusive particle undergoes a Brownian motion, so the distance goes like the square of the time. So when you integrate with x squared, you pick up a linear in time coefficient and a linear in time term, and the coefficient is the Onsager matrix, which is the same as the diffusion up to a prefactor, which is the charge susceptibility. And generically, these are the only two terms that appear, and then there are subleading terms that are subleading at large time. You can also redefine these matrices in terms of correlators of the currents instead of the charge density. So basically, the Drude weight is the time average, long time average of the self correlator of the current, and the Onsager matrix is the integral after you subtract the constant, which would make this integral diverge. Physically, also, you can see it in a different way. If you consider the conductivity at zero momentum, the ballistic part will give rise to a delta function contribution in frequency. And the Onsager matrix will essentially be the DC conductivity, so the zero frequency conductivity. And then you will have corrections at higher order in omega. So these are the things that we are interested in computing. And the nice way to do it is to use the so-called partitioning protocol, or can also be understood as an inhomogeneous quench, where you set up the system in...
Sorry, can I have a question?
Sure.
So I have a very nice question. So in 1+1 dimensional conformal field theories, right, like the conservation of the stress tensor makes propagation trivial in a sense that there's like a left or right moving bump of matter, right?
Yes.
And they just move without changing the form with the speed of light. Can you explain like what kind of expectations do you have in the context of you know, like what you want to do in 1+1 dimension?
Well, this is going to come up in the next few slides, but okay, I can say something now. Yeah, basically in CFT this transport is rather trivial, but the idea of the deformation is that it describes what happens away from the conformal point. So what corrections arise because of the breaking of conformal invariants. So You have in the CFT, you have left and right excitations. Basically, they move independently and don't talk to each other. But any perturbation will couple the two, so we'll make left and right movers interact, and then you will have some effect on the transport. Now, typically, this arises in a real system because you have underlying physics, which can be a lattice, so you have terms that break the translational invariant. This is not captured by the TTbar deformation, which preserves the translational invariance. So it's not completely general. In some cases, however, this it can be the leading, the least irrelevant perturbation.
So this is an irrelevant perturbation. So in the infrared, like you expect that it dies away, right?
Right.
So at long distances, like you don't expect to the appearance of the hydrodynamic degrees of freedom, or do you? Because I mean, at long distances, at low momenta, you would expect that the behavior is like, you know, like two stuff passing through each other as you would get in a CFT. But at, you know, at intermediate momenta, maybe some other things can happen because of this effect of the formation. So is this intuition correct, or there are some surprises on the way?
Well, even though, I mean, at large, even though it's an irrelevant perturbation and it dies away in the infrared, but the question is how fast does it die away? And so if you assume that there is a hydrodynamic description, and that's what we found, is that the hydrodynamics becomes non-trivial, so it's it doesn't behave like the CFT anymore. And now I don't know if this is, it may be surprising from some point of view, not surprising from other point of view. So it's a bit hard for me to say if this is unexpected or not.
No, thanks. I mean, I'm looking forward to seeing what you have to say next.
Sorry, could I also ask a naive question? And is it even clear, maybe you mentioned it, but I missed it. Is it even clear that under this deformation, thermodynamics is still properly defined because of this higher down growth, or is it because you're taking this small sigma limit?
Yeah, so the small sigma limit is only relevant for the large C limit. Otherwise, so in the holographic case, we are confined to this small sigma limit. In general, not, but it's true that, yeah, when you go to high temperature, you should start seeing some problems, but we are looking at the small temperature expansion.
Okay, the finite temperature partition function is still well-defined.
It's still well-defined up to the Hagedorn temperature. Yes, so I was saying that a convenient way to compute these coefficients is to introduce this partitioning protocol where you set up the system at two different states, initially independent left and right parts. They can be set up at different temperatures, then you put them in contact at T equals zero, and the two parts will start to see each other and create a non-equilibrium steady state in the middle, which will expand with some velocity. And when you are at late time, the whole system is covered by this steady state and non-equilibrium steady state. And this, if you can compute the non-equilibrium current, then you have access to all this information. Basically, the Drude weight will be given by the derivative of the non-equilibrium current with respect to the temperature difference. And the Onsager coefficient, again, by some subtracted part of the current, also the variation of the integrated part of the integrated current after you subtract the constant part. The non-equilibrium steady state current for the energy also is important, because if you can compute it for arbitrary left and right temperatures, then you have access to a function which is the generating function of the energy fluctuations. So it contains much more information. You can also basically compute all the cumulants of the energy fluctuations. And this is known as the extended fluctuation relation, as explained in this paper of Bernard and Doyon. And basically, the transport coefficients that I defined correspond to the first order expansion of this in this parameter lambda in the temperature difference. But you can have information in all orders. Now, as Michael pointed out, in CFT, the situation is quite trivial. There is just ballistic transport. There is no diffusion, so the Onsager matrix is exactly zero. The Drude weights can be computed exactly. They have this universal form, just depends on the central charge, and beta cube is a bidimensional analysis. And you can compute also the exact energy and momentum steady state current. And in the energy current, you can observe that it has this form. It's a difference. It's a function of left minus function of right temperature. And one can show that this actually is a consequence of the chiral separation. So the fact that you have chiral excitations that move separately, it leads easily to this form of the steady state current for the energy. Actually, in a CFT, because you have so much symmetry, you can even solve a more general problem where the initial temperature profile is not discontinuous, but is a generic function. And you get again this difference of left and right movers, but with a function which is related to the Schwarzian derivative of the temperature profile. We don't know how to get such a result for a TTbar deformation to deny.
Is there an obvious way why it's the Schwarzian? Is like the, is it related to kind of a state without a temperature difference? Also, without any quench by coordinate transformation or something? Like, I don't know, why does the Schwarzian appear?
Yeah, of course, the Schwarzian appears as always because you know, the finite temperature is conformally related to the zero temperature case. So it's the expectation value of the energy of the stress energy tensor is given by the Schwarzian of this conformal map.
I see.
Now, as we can see, when we do the deformation, there are some non-trivial things happening. So, first of all, we want to find what is the steady state in the deformed description, or basically, what is a black hole in the TTbar theory. We have to impose the flatness of the metric for the deformed boundary metric, this gamma mu. And as I said, because the metric is flat, in general, you know that the solution can be obtained by a change of coordinates. And if you start from the generic solution in Fermat-Gram coordinates described by left movers and right movers, L and L bar, you can implement this coordinate transformation in this way, which is basically the same as I showed before, given by Cardi for the coordinate transformation. So here I have these different coordinates, big U and big V are the flat coordinates of the deformed theory, whereas U and V are the original Fermat-Gram coordinates, where the metric, where you know the exact solution for the metric. So in order to find the metric, what you would need to do is to solve for this equation for small u and small v in terms of capital U and capital V and plug it in the metric, and you would find the deformed black hole solution. However, because of this integral, you cannot do this inversion explicitly. except in some cases. So one simple case is when L and L bar are constant. So this describes an equilibrium state. And then this this becomes linear equations that you can invert, and you find the metric explicitly. And you can see that there are some deformed relations for the stress energy tensor components and the temperature in terms of the parameters that describe the excitations. So this describes the black hole in the deformed geometry, a rotating black hole, because it also has some angular momentum. And when you have this, then you can do the holographic implementation of the quenching protocol. This was done in 15 in this paper of Konrad Schalm and collaborators for the CFT case. And here we just extend it to the formation. It's actually quite simple. So as I said, the solution in Pfefferman-Gram coordinates is exactly the same. And here the quenching is implemented by imposing discontinuous boundary conditions at equal time. So when time equals zero, you can see that you have u equal v is essentially the space coordinate, and then this the function implements the discontinuous boundary conditions, initial conditions. But then, because this L is supposed to be a function, a sum of left and right movers, this theta actually must have arguments, the light cone coordinates. And here, sorry, there is a mistake. It should be U for the left movers, but here should be V for the right movers. And the solution then propagates. There is a discontinuity on the light cone at u equal zero or v equal zero. And this is interpreted as some kind of shock waves. Although it's not really a shock wave in one plus one dimension, it would be a shock wave in higher dimension, but in one plus one, it's just a discontinuity.
The best question.
Yeah.
It looks to me that you should have two different temperatures on the CFT side, right?
Yeah, there are four parameters here, L left, L right, L bar left, L bar right. This corresponds actually, if you look at here, to a beta left, and beta right, omega right. So on each side, you have different temperature, different angular momentum.
Okay, and So after the shock wave, so in the gravitational side, it's that after the shock wave, then on the other side it has a different temperature and.
No, the picture is this one. So you have here some temperature, some angular momentum. I mean, we are not on the circle; we are on the line. So it's not angular momentum; it's just momentum. Mm-hmm. So it's a kind of boosted thermal state. Here it's another boosted thermal state with different parameters. When they are in contact, you create another state which has now a different temperature and different momentum, which will be related to the original ones on the left and on the right. So this this state that emerges in the middle is a function of the initial states on the left and on the right.
Okay, so now in the lower part of the picture, there are three temperatures.
Yeah, there are three. We are only interested in the middle one.
Okay, I see. Thanks.
And the middle one, it's clearly is defined by some combination where you see when the theta functions are zero or non-zero. This defines three different regions when U is both are less than zero, or one is less and one is more. But the non-trivial point here is that this is defined in the Pfefferman-Gram coordinates, and we have to translate into the flat coordinates of the form theory. This means that the light cone gets modified. It will not be on the light cone anymore, but it will have a new velocity, which depends on the deformation and also on the initial state. So it's a function of temperatures and momentum. But however, it remains it remains ballistic. At least this wavefront or this shock profile remains ballistic. So at the level of gravity, we observe no broadening of the shock profile. So it would seem like there is just ballistic propagation with the modified velocity. The steady state current, I give the expression only in the particular case of zero angular momentum, initial angular momentum. Otherwise, they are very complicated. But the thing to observe is that here the chiral separation is broken. So the steady state current is no longer a difference of left and right state. So the non-broadening of the shock profile seems like the theory is behaving like a CFT. However, this chiral separation is broken. So this is a non-trivial fact that in keeping with the Michael observation, it's non-trivial or non-unexpected situation, a consequence of the deformation. And then from this, we get some universal expression for the Drude weight. So we found that actually they are given purely in terms of thermodynamic quantities. So the energy is the sum of energy density and pressure divided by temperature. In a CFT, the momentum weight would be the same as the energy weight because they are related to each other by symmetry. With the deformation, they become different, but the difference is also given by some universal combination, just the pressure over energy squared. And this effective velocity is given by this formula, so it's temperature dependent. And here again, you can see that if sigma becomes too big, then this becomes complex. And you would say that the hydrodynamic breaks down, but actually we know that it's the whole theory that becomes ill-defined. Now, even though you don't see it in gravity, you can actually show that there is diffusion in the theory. And this can be shown from conformal perturbation theory. Because this TTbar deformation preserves Lorentz invariants, one can show generally that this implies that the Onsager coefficient for energy and energy momentum are still zero. But the momentum does not have to be zero. So this is related to the two-point function of the momentum current, which is TXX. And then by using the fact that this is the only non-trivial non-zero component, we can equivalently also add the TTT for free because it's not going to contribute. And then we replace this as a correlator of the trace. And at leading order, the trace is equal to TT bar. So to second order, we have this equation that the Onsager matrix is sigma squared times the correlator of TT bar with itself. And now to leading order, we can compute this in the undeformed theory. And so it just factorized in left hand mover. And we have this this expression for the finite temperature TT times T bar correlator. And when you plug it in the formula for the Onsager matrix, you have to regularize this because this will be divergent. The simplest way is to regularize by continuation in the scaling dimension. So instead of computing for T, which has dimension 2, we compute this for a correlator of operator of dimension H. And we get such an expression for the finite temperature correlator, where B is the Barnes function, which is a ratio of gamma functions. And then when you put this in the formula, you find that there is a finite diffusion. So basically the diffusion constant will be the imaginary part of this expanded for small omega and zero momentum. And you find that it is non-zero and is given by this expression. But this is the Onsager matrix. Now, the diffusion is the Onsager divided by the susceptibility, which turns out to be equal to the energy Drude weight. And then the diffusion has this formula, has this form. So it goes like C sigma squared. And now in the scaling limit that is relevant to gravity, this is actually suppressed by 1 over C. And that's the reason why we don't observe diffusion in the gravity solution, even though conformal perturbation is in which the theory differs from a conformal field theory in that it it has diffusion. This is what you would expect in general for a perturbation that scatters left and right movers. You would think, at least from a statistical or condensed matter perspective, that generically this would lead to diffusion. And maybe the specificity of TTbar, you would wonder if this is enough to preserve the ballistic propagation, as you could maybe argue from this picture of CFT in deformed geometry. But actually the calculation shows that, it is diffusive. So if there are no questions, and how much time do I have?
You still have 10 minutes, around 10 minutes.
Okay, then I go to the generalized hydrodynamics part.
It's generalized. Sorry, can I still have a question about what you just said?
Yeah.
So what's the statement about the correlators of the stress tensor? I guess diffusivity, the diffusion coefficient can define in terms of the correlator of the stress tensor, right? The correlator of the stress tensor in the thermal state in field theory, it's trivial. It does not have this behavior, right, because of the reasons that we just talked about.
Mm-hmm.
When you move the cutoff into the bulk, like, it doesn't seem that there's much things that you can do with gravity, right? Like, so probably like this, the statement that diffusivity is like 1/c suppressed, like, should translate into sort of triviality of the retarded correlator of the stress tensor in TTbar deformed holographic theories, right?
To at the classical level, yes.
Yeah, I'm just talking about the classical level. Yeah.
Yeah, I think so. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, normally we associate diffusion with properties of the solution, gravity solution around the horizon. The TTbar deformation does not do very much, does nothing basically to the horizon. So that's an intuitive way to, as you say, to understand why you would think that gravity will not show diffusion, and indeed it's true.
Okay, so in TTbar deformed holographic theories, you don't expect fluid gravity duality to have a non-trivial content.
Well, not at this level. But there is some content, maybe when you consider higher conserved charges. So this is the next part. Indeed, if you just look at gravity itself, which is energy momentum tensor, you don't expect very much. But there may be more information in the higher conserved charges. So that's where generalized hydrodynamics come in, although this has not been done yet. Zamorodchikov again in this paper, actually series of papers, argue that you can give an integrable structure interpretation of CFTs, or at least some CFTs. So for all CFTs, actually, you can construct polynomials of the stress energy tensor and extract conserved charges that commute. So formally, there is always some integrable structure in any CFT. But it turns out that it is only really useful in some cases where you can use this structure to solve the model. So for minimal models. And I don't know if it is really known which theories are really integrable or not, or if it is a well-defined question. But anyway, the fact that there is an infinite set of conserved charges, it prevents the system from thermalizing in the usual sense, because the conserved charges cannot relax to equilibrium value. So the equilibrium density matrix has to be replaced by a generalized Gibbs ensemble, where you keep track of all the conserved charges with some chemical potentials. And then this idea leads to generalizing hydrodynamics by allowing all these chemical potentials to fluctuate at long distance scales. Then you get an infinite set of conserved charges that you have to solve for. Now in the case, because integrability basically implies that you only have two bodies scattering where the momenta can only be exchanged and not changed really in the collision. So there can only be exchange of momenta and the phase shift. And this has some consequence that you can, for any theory, you can define quasi-particles. For an integrable theory, you can define quasi-particles by just tracking the momentum, as you can see in this picture. Instead of tracking the actual particle, you just associate a quasi-particle to the momenta that cannot jump in value across the trajectory. And then in a way you can recast all these theories as almost free theories, in the sense that you can associate many of the concepts of free theory. So you can define a quasi-particle density, and the conserved charges will be given by integrals of this density times the eigenvalue of the charge associated to a single particle state. This is this HI. But the effect of the interaction will be to renormalize the state density. And so you also have a concept of occupation number as a ratio of particle density divided by the available state density phase space, if you want. And the free energy will again have a free particle form in which you integrate over the single particle free energy, which would be this formula if you are dealing with fermions, or the corresponding formula for bosons. And then the occupation number will be, just as in free theories, will be given by the derivative of this with respect to the energy. But the crucial point is that the energy is not the bare energy. It is also renormalized by the interaction, and it satisfies this nonlinear integral equation. This follows from the Bethe ansatz. And this, okay, is in general non-trivial to solve. You need to solve this integral equation, which involves the scattering kernel of the theory. In a relativistic theory, because you have crossing symmetry, you can exchange energy and momentum, and you get an expression also for the current density, which is the same as the charge, with the difference that there is an effective velocity appearing, where the effective velocity is as the ordinary expression in terms of energy and momentum, except that these quantities have to be dressed again as a consequence of the scattering. So there is a whole formalism that was developed in these papers that I studied here, which started this developments of generalized hydrodynamics. So the physical picture here is that this effective velocity is basically what emerges from the accumulated phase shift that each particle or quasi-particle encounters in the course of the trajectory. You can see this clearly in this numerical simulation, that when the particles are moving in the vacuum, they just have a velocity, but when they start encountering other particles in the opposite direction on long time scale, they change their effective velocity. What this equation, this formalism, basically it's useful because it allows to take diagonalize in a way the generalized equations. They just become a family of ordinary looking Navier-Stokes equations, except that they are parameterized by a momentum in addition to space and time. And this effective velocity has to be calculated from the equation. So even though the equations look simple, it's quite difficult in general to get a description of the system, because you have this continuous parameter of states, continuous family of states. And in the literature, people, at least in this community of that looks at GHD, there has been some work on looking at zero entropy states, so-called. You can think of them as basically states determined by the shape of a Fermi surface, and then you just have to keep track of the endpoints of the of the Fermi surface to find the dynamics. But this is not the most general state that you can consider. Now, for the application to TTbar, first of all, here I have assumed in all this formula that there was a single particle species, but this can be generalized to the case where there are many particle species. And for TTbar, for CFT, we have in particular to keep track of left and right movers. So everything has to be doubled. We have plus and minus corresponding to left and right movers. And the scattering kernel is this phase shift of this matrix that I told you about in the beginning, has this particular expression. And because this is quite simple, actually, it turns out that you can do many calculations explicitly. We just looked at the simplest equilibrium state by setting to zero all the higher conserved charges, so we just keep the normal Gibbs ensemble. And there are two simplifications that occur, that the nonlinear equation for the energies, that in general this would be an equation for epsilon plus, an equation for epsilon minus, and they would be coupled by the scattering kernel, so we would have two coupled equations to solve. But actually you can massage this expression into a decoupled equation. So you have two different equations for the pseudo energies left and right. And basically the effect of the interaction has been reabsorbed into this redefinition of the chemical potentials, which appears here as a prefactor. And this phi zero is not, this phi zero is the kernel of the undeformed theory. So all the effect of the deformation has been subsumed in this simple correction to the nonlinear equation. And then the other important fact is that the effective velocity, which is in general a function of momentum, in fact, in this case, it's momentum independent, and it has this general expression in terms of the deformation parameter, and rho plus and rho minus are the densities of left and right moving excitations. So the consequence is that you can decouple for the energy momentum densities the equations from all the infinite tower of equations, and then it can be solved separately. So once again, we see here that the difference and the similarities with the undeformed CFT, the similarity is that the equations are decoupled, and the difference is that here you have this non-trivial function, which is actually just the free energy of the independent excitation, quasi-particle excitations. Then there are some formulas that people have derived to compute the transport coefficients in this formalism. So because we can compute everything explicitly, you just do the computation and okay, it's not so easy, but you can do it and you find these formulas which look different from the ones that I gave from the holography, but in fact they coincide if you plug in the expression for the effective velocity. And for the diffusion constant, you get this also exact expression, which starts at sigma squared, as we knew from conformal perturbation theory. But here, this is actually to all orders in sigma, because the effective velocity and the Drude weight are also sigma dependent. So we see that we confirm the result from holography, but in a different regime, because here it does not apply to large C. C can be arbitrary. On the other hand, it relies on the application of the integrability techniques, which is not supposed to be applied for any CFT. However, we get precise agreement, and so we take this as an indication that these formulas are actually completely universal for CFT. And one final observation is that this formula for the diffusion constant, or this one, is reminiscent of diffusivity bounds that have been derived holographically, but typically in a higher dimension. And typically they have this this form that the diffusion constant is bound by some velocity dependent factor, normally is v squared, divided by the temperature. This would be in 2+1 dimension, for example. But this velocity is the butterfly velocity, so the velocity of propagation of the entanglement perturbation, whereas here it's replaced by this effective velocity.
Can you relate it to?
I think they are probably related. Yes, I haven't checked actually, but my guess would be that they should be related. I don't think there is another velocity appearing in the problem, but yeah, it should be checked. And yeah, I also want to draw attention to the fact of this formula for the diffusion constant is given by an integral, where the you have this difference of effective velocities at different momenta up here. So in a way, you can think that, as I said, this in this quasi particle momentum basis, you have diagonalized the excitation. So this effective velocity, you can think of them as kind of normal modes of the system. And so we have a diffusion coefficient expressed in terms of normal modes. And you have to compare this with the normal holographic interpretation, where we associate diffusion to the presence of quasi-normal modes. To the imaginary part of the quasi-normal frequency. So it seems that here the mechanism of diffusion is different than what we normally expect in holography. As I already said many times, it's not arising classically, but it only has to do with quantum effects. And so this formula gives some indication perhaps of a different route to diffusion that should emerge, but it has not been explored. I'm finishing now. This is the summary. As I said, we analyzed the system from two different perspectives, the holographic setup and the approach using integrability and generalized hydrodynamics. We have consistent results in different regimes of validity. You could try to find some theory that in which both techniques apply simultaneously. This would be Liouville theory, where you can take the large C limit and arguably, it should satisfy both requirements. However, there are some subtleties in Liouville theories which prevented us from actually doing this calculation. Basically, there is some problem in taking the large C limit in this of this of the theory for large rapidities. And it's not quite obvious how to do this in the largest limit. Basically, it looks like you would have to have some discontinuous asymptotics, and we could not find out. But it's an interesting problem to see how it works. As I said, the TTbar deformed CFT has hydrodynamics, non-trivial hydrodynamics. In particular, it has diffusion, but is suppressed as 1 over C. The energy momentum transport appears to be universal, and so it does not discriminate between CFTs that are rational or integrable and chaotic. So in particular, we don't know if there is any relation of these two pulse skipping. Probably not, because pulse skipping is related to horizon physics, and again, TTbar does not affect the horizon. So this correspondence seems to break down in this particular case. There is a description of the theory. I didn't talk about it because it's not my area of expertise, but this is the mostly my collaborator Marco, who pointed out that there is a certain model of cellular automata which whose equations of motion are exactly the same as the hydrodynamics of TTbar with this form for the effective velocity. So there seems to be a curious way to exactly describe the system with the discrete cellular automaton, but I don't have much to say about that. Now, the open questions that I would like to think about is if we can see some signs of the integrability structures in the holographic picture, and in particular, as Michal asked, can we derive a kind of fluid gravity correspondence, but not in the usual sense, but in the sense that what should emerge is the generalized hydrodynamics, and then have a gravity picture of this formula that gives you diffusion from the normal modes. So I think that would be a very interesting connection to make. But for this, one needs to extend our work to consider the transport of higher conserved charges. There is a little work has been done on this, mostly by this paper of Leflocq and Mezzei, where they analyzed the spectrum of the conserved charges along the flow, and they saw that they don't contribute themselves to the Burgers equation, but they just kind of ride along the flow induced by the deformation. However, you can also use these charges to add additional deformations. So deformations that also break the Lorentz invariance. So more generally, you could have a TS T-bar S prime deformation where S and S prime are different spins in this hierarchy of conserved charges. And because of the Lorentz breaking, this will have probably an even richer transport structure with also energy diffusion and higher conserved charges diffusion. It would be interesting to see if one can derive the full matrix of transport coefficients for all the charges. Also, an interesting thing is that in some models, some lattice models, one can see the emergence of transport which is not exactly diffusive, but as sub-diffusive or super-diffusive behavior. So still less than ballistic, but more than diffusive, some intermediate regime. It would be nice to understand how one would model this in holography, and it's not clear to me if it's expected that this should appear classically or quantum mechanically again. And then one can also think about extending this to higher dimensional cases, where of course it's much more complicated than all these equivalent descriptions of TTbar that I talked in the beginning. Each particular aspect you may try to extend in a higher dimension, but most likely they will not be related to each other anymore. So you have to choose which is the most promising thing that you can try to generalize. And maybe the easiest thing I think is would be to generalize the picture of coordinate transformation. That seems to me that it could admit more easily an extension to higher dimension, but I don't quite know how to do it for the moment. Okay, that's all.
Thanks for the very nice talk. Maybe we can still take like one or two questions. And if people would still like to ask questions, we can like do it after. Would anyone be willing to ask a question?
Can you think about hydrodynamics with, say, JT deformations or something like that?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, this is one particular case of this different spin deformations. Well, not exactly. Here I was talking only about this higher spin generalization of stress energy tensor, but that would probably be the simplest case of Lorentz breaking deformation. Mm-hmm. And there is already a holographic dictionary for that, so one knows what is the holographic dual.
Thanks, that was very interesting.
Thank you.
I still have one question, and because it seems to me that you were saying once we consider the region that is near the horizon, then we cannot see the TTbar deformation. But supposing we take the TTbar parameter to be really large and adopt the Velinde-Mitsay description, then we should be able to see the TTbar deformed effects near the horizon, right?
Well, yeah, I guess. But then you're approaching the point where the theory stops making sense. So it seems a bit dangerous. I don't know. But yeah, you're right. Of course, in that regime, it's a bit extreme. But yeah, in that regime, you are seeing the effects closer to the horizon. But I'm not sure if it makes sense to take this limit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe is it because that you cannot take this sigma to be large in your description?
Uh-huh. Yeah, it cannot be too large. So I mean, maybe you can try to make some holographic picture of the fact that the theory is breaking down, but. If you take it literally, then you would say that the whole space is just contained inside the horizon and there is no asymptotic. There is no asymptotic part of the space time.
Yeah, I mean, that's somehow the picture in my mind. We truncate all the space that is far away.
Yeah. But yeah, I don't know if one can make sense of that.
Thanks. It's very interesting.
May I ask a question about the system that was split into two subsystems sitting at two different temperatures? I think, sorry if you talked about this already and I missed it, but it was either in the original work by Konrad or by Johanna subsequently, where they calculated the entanglement entropy of an interval mm-hmm. in the system.
Yeah.
Do you know if the effect of the TTbar is just to slow that down because you have a slightly different effective velocity, but the shape is basically the same? Or is the diffusion, does the diffusion have a more interesting effect?
Well, the diffusion, I guess, would have an interesting effect if you, but you don't see it classically. So yeah, so you know, islands or calculating the effect of islands in this case. I mean, the classical picture, the Ryutake and Nagi surface, I think will just show the slowing down of the, actually it's not slowing down, the effective velocity is more than the speed of light. But yeah, it's just, would just be the effect, I think, of this modified light cone.
I see.
But if you would see the diffusion in some island contributions, maybe, I don't know.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think we had received enough questions today. So maybe let's thank Giuseppe again. Thanks for this very interesting and detailed work. And if anyone who would like to stay or interact could still do that, I will stop the recording.